Hi, everybody. Welcome to Adobe Live on Behance.net. My name is Michael Jarrett. I'm here with Lucas Albrecht. Today is day three. We've been working in InDesign, doing some really cool editorial work, kind of pushing the limits of InDesign. So if you're just joining us for the first time, get ready to see some really awesome stuff. We're going to have fun with it, kind of go off the cuff, and we invite you to participate. Just let's take a look at what we've done this entire week. This is the final day of streaming, and this is the final stream of the day. But earlier, we had some incredible guests joining us all week, Rachel Roth and Stephanie Brookler. Again, we're here with Lucas Albrecht right now. So let us know where you're from in the chat. Say hi. If this is your first time watching, we'd love to know that as well. Couple of things. We're going to do a chat and win segment in about 30 minutes. And so if you're participating in chat, saying hello, something like that, we're gonna pick a random winner and give away this free Creative Cloud pillow. It's nice and firm. It's gonna be good for a nap, probably. So that'll be in about 30 minutes. Just go ahead and say hey, ask some questions. We'll let you know when that's coming up, and one random winner will win this pillow. And then later in the segment, at an hour and a half in, we're gonna be doing some portfolio reviews. So we'll pick two portfolios to review. We'll have those decided beforehand, and about an hour and a half in, we'll take a look at the Behance pages, provide some feedback on the work and the overall curation of it. We got really incredibly smart Lucas here, who's provided some amazing commentary and feedback on our earlier challenges this week. So that should be a really good opportunity to get some professional advice on what your portfolio is looking like. So, day three. Let's do a quick recap of the type of work that we've been working on this week, what we're doing, what the purpose is. We're in InDesign doing some editorial design. Mm-hmm.
So we started off kind of breaking down the project. So just to give a quick recap, we're kind of making this publication. I guess it's the word I'm most comfortable with right now. It's a publication about design as a generative practice. In this publication, we're going to have an archive of projects, an essay that kind of deals with design as a generative process. Not too wonderful of an essay, but like a brief sort of description of what I mean by that. An archive of projects that I think get to the spirit of that kind of working. We're hoping to make the publication itself a play on these ideas. So I think we're kind of going through a Rolodex of different methodologies and processes that play with making tools to make tools, or breaking processes to get like different kinds of results that we usually do.
Yeah, and something I think that's really interesting, in this particular publication that we've been working on all week, we've been inviting users to sort of like vote on things that we add to it or provide names for things, help us make decisions. A lot of the decisions we've been sort of making as part of the live stream, and I know you're particularly have been interested in the entire live stream actually encapsulating the process of making this, and that itself is the object.
I was pretty excited about the whole like spectacle of this production and kind of using it as like, you know, a way to generate form in a way and generate content. So the chat's been great. We got some nice Ninja Turtles design because of it, so it's been good so far.
That's right. So what's the plan for today? What are we gonna hope to accomplish?
We have a lot to get through today.
Okay.
We're going to flow in this sort of like short essay, work through that with some images, and we're gonna work through the archive, which is really just a few projects that I think get to the spirit of this thing that I think might be a good reference for people if they are interested in kind of breaking their own design process and playing with that and just thinking through what that could mean. And then we're going to kind of just look at the whole thing as a whole and see where we're at and make some decisions.
Cool. I know we can do that. So let's get started. And while we're working, if anybody has questions about Lucas's work or his process about InDesign or editorial design in particular, don't be afraid to ask in the chat. We're gonna take a few breaks to look and answer those questions. It's always really nice to have the chat involved with us. We've had some fun with it over the past 2 days. So don't be shy, keep those questions coming.
Cool, so yesterday we spent quite a bit of time trying to get through some of these images for the cover, and we kind of even had a little bit of a vote. This came from a selfie that we took And then we brought it into TextEdit and purposely kind of broke that image. I think it's another example. I kind of took some time once I left to work through that. You know, we have a limited time to get through stuff here. So this is what I came up with for the cover. If you guys remember what it was like yesterday, I thought it was, you know, we got almost like everything in there. And then I started to work through, here's like, you know, the back cover. I'll place that properly once we have one. But I thought, you know, it would be a good example to see like, you know, where we were yesterday and what it looks like for me to just kind of work through it just a little longer. You know, this is kind of an exercise where we're constantly kind of working through things and making things. And I don't think by the end we're going to end up with something necessarily like super tight and finessed. But this is just like one step that way. And I thought maybe to even keep that sort of like more aggressive and dynamic image that we got from the text edit glitching. And it's sort of like a weird welcome screen
it's
or something.
Nice. And it's kind of like expansive too within the frame.
Yeah, there's a lot of movement in it that I think is really fascinating. I still think it looks a little bit like Hacking 101 image or something that you would see like, you know, if somebody in like, I don't know, like Mr. Robot or like, I don't know, a TV show about hacking or something. Like if they were like fake hacking and you saw their screen, it would look like this or The Matrix or something. So it's a little hokey or something, but I'm still kind of into it because of the color.
Right. And, yeah.
Yeah. So we're just going to let it ride. And then I'll kind of just go scroll through a little bit of what we have so far. And then we came into the intro and we got that going, which, you know, I came and I kind of mined this process and I brought it back to the cover for like our subtitle, which was Snakes in the Grain. And it's kind of like Zakes. Which is kind of cool. And then our title, which was The Thing from the Adobe Lagoon. It's kind of stretched back there and kind of just becoming form, which maybe like, you know, foreshadows this kind of stretch type thing that we only come across again a few spreads in. Foreshadowing is not a technical design term. It's like a literary term, but I like that idea of like maybe not explicitly introducing a move and then doing it, but maybe like hinting at a move that you do later on. What that means as far as like the experience of like going through the publication, I'm not totally sure, but in my head, as far as structuring flow through something, it makes sense.
Well, and I think that's how foreshadowing almost kind of does apply in this sense, because you're anticipating a flow that implies narrative, and that allows you to maybe borrow some literary terms and use them as design terms.
Totally.
Cool.
So I'm gonna go ahead and grab this, you know, essay is maybe like a generous term for what we have going on here. It's just like a couple paragraphs that I've kind of wrote slash mined from something I wrote previously.
Okay.
So we have a text box here. I've placed it in. I'm going to, it's, you know, I have my character style preset with SETO 14 by 16. I'm going to go ahead and have it hit the X height, so baseline options, first baseline offset X height, boom, 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 which means that as the text flows, I have a very sort of like loose baseline grid, if that makes any sense, not an oxymoron, but so I'm hitting, you know, as you can see, like I start flowing here, this sort of like environmental information that we have on every spread is also obeying it, so.
How often do you find yourself aligning to a baseline grid that's set to the X height as opposed to the baseline itself?
Well, theoretically, it's doing both, right? So it's hitting up top at an X height. And I think that depending on how I'm starting a project, I will do, you know, the way that I pair type, usually I'm looking at sort of the X height and to the cap height relationship and see if both type like relates to one another. And there's different ways to sort of look at those pairings. But when I'm setting up a baseline grid, I'm looking at both of those things, I guess, because you can start hitting. It's all about optical alignment.
Right.
So even if you're doing a baseline and you have different size type, you can have that different size type hit the same baseline, but optically maybe it's not aligning. So maybe your smaller type size can have its like, you know, cap height match the X height of your larger or something like that. So it's all about optical alignment and
The relationship between
totally
different pieces of type.
And I'm not always obeying a baseline grid, it really depends on what I'm trying to do. Generally speaking, I like them, but that's not the only name in the game. So we have this amount of text, which you guys can see is not totally, you know, it's not super long. Kind of want to milk it a little bit. So let's see what we can do with it. I'm gonna go ahead and pull another column here. Maybe we pull into a column.
Sal Lippman asks, how did you learn to break the image? I think he's referring to the selfie. And what in the world prompted you to do it the first time?
I think I randomly ran across it. And I originally ran across someone pulling it into, if I'm not mistaken, what was it? It was into Ableton. Like pulling an image into Ableton and applying, I have no idea. It was such a complicated and like convoluted process that I attempted and got nothing from. Like I just couldn't make it do what I saw the guy doing. It was like a pretty, it was like there were more steps to it than just like dragging it into it, I think. Yeah. but he was manipulating an image through Ableton, which sounded insane. I tried and then I couldn't figure it out and I ended up just like Googling like glitching an image. And then the first thing is like, oh, I just pull, you know, drag a, you know, like a JPEG into TextEdit and just like delete random things. And I was like, that sounds easier. Let me try that.
Yeah. For those of you that aren't aware, yesterday we pulled in JPEG images inside of a Mac OS native text edit solution. And what it produces when you pull the image in is just a bunch of what appears to be completely random symbols and strings of numbers and characters. And if you edit that text, deleting things, copy and pasting, and then saving, the JPEG image starts to produce artifacts and corrupt and kind of destroy in interesting ways. And that's actually how we were able to get some of these really interesting images mm-hmm. that we saw earlier.
And just to recap real quick, I think you guys just saw me generate a new spread through the script. Just like a little reminder, we have, you know, date and time, whatever's going on with the news right now. A frame from an animation that I did previously, how we're doing with weather in San Francisco, an update on Ethereum, and a screenshot of the chat and the feed for Adobe Live. So you guys are immortalized. I'm just kind of like making some boxes with the text as we have it so far and kind of throwing them in here and seeing if there's like an interesting relationship between them, but I think that's probably not quite enough to get through what I want to say with this stuff. So let's go ahead and take some screenshots because I love screenshots. I think one big part of the story of what we're doing here is this master page. So I'm gonna go ahead and take a that's Shift Command 4 and then Spacebar to take a screenshot of your entire window. So, capture that. I think another thing that's, I don't know if I've shown yet, but it's what's going on in Terminal. I'm gonna take a screenshot of that.
And what is going on? I mean, does what's going on in Terminal have a relationship to what we're doing in InDesign, or is that just...
Yeah, that's like, that question is way above my pay grade, but essentially, I kick off that, I open up the connection to the network of computers that I talked through a little bit earlier. So this kind of gets it going. We pay for space for like every screenshot that we take if it goes over a certain size, so I have to like kind of turn it off when I stop and start it up again when I get started working. So this, you know, the scripting in InDesign isn't doing that much of the work. It's really just pulling the things in
right.
that are being generated by this, you know, network of computers where each computer is responsible for a different task. But yeah, so, you know, and all of this is happening through, there's a master setup where each individual component is named within the layer, so that the script knows where to put each piece of content. And then all that stuff's happening through here. Like I mentioned, once we're done with the project and we post it on Behance, I'll add a link to GitHub where I'll make all the files available so you guys can go crazy then and totally ask questions in Behance, and I'll make sure that the right person with the right background, / Sam, gets you some answers. So we have a screenshot of the master, we have a screenshot of Terminal, and now we'll get a screenshot of Sam's website.
Just sort of documenting the pieces that sort of make this work, mm-hmm. all the component pieces, and then placing them inside the object itself.
Totally, and I'm more or less, so I'm not, you know, that organized, which means that my desktop is usually a mess. I've kind of cleared it up just to make it like a working space for, you know, this specific project. So as you may notice, there's a folder called Clutter.
Yeah, I have one called Everything.
Inside of the Clutter folder, there's a folder called Everything.
All right.
So it's like, it just keeps happening. So yeah, like mostly I left my desktop open for just the stuff that's going on here. So I can just kind of grab this stuff and just put it on my desktop for now as a way to keep it organized. And then maybe this is breaking a rule here or something, but I went ahead and took some photos of the space.
Of the studio space.
Yeah.
Great.
And I figured I should include that in there.
Yeah.
Hopefully no one's going to yell at me for that. I forgot to ask if that's okay. But, you know, clearly not me there. But you guys get to see that.
Nice. So for those of you that don't know exactly what the space that we're broadcasting from looks like, we'll get a little bit of a peek inside today.
Cool. So let's bring all of that in here.
Okay. Yeah, we got a lot of people talking about the text edit hack, the trick.
Are they trying it? I didn't come up with this. It's been around for a long time. I think someone's mentioning it.
Yeah, Rodney's got some information about it. Certain areas of the image, you delete it or adjust it or something, and then the whole thing goes corrupt, and
right.
It's kind of random. So we've also, I have seen some kudos for the design and layout of this thing. A lot of people are saying that some of these spreads are really gorgeous. And
I'm glad they're into it. Like I said, I think based on what this project's been all about and sort of the way that we're like handling it, I'm really like thinking of it like as an exercise to generate form and kind of work through it. So maybe some of this stuff isn't, you know, it doesn't have to stay the way that it is. I think an example is like, this is where I got, but I needed everything along the way to get here.
Right.
And, you know, I don't think this would be like in real world, like a final version. Necessarily, depending on the spirit of the thing, if I wanted it to be like really fluid and feel natural, then maybe I would stop here, but maybe I would work through it even a little bit more. Maybe I would want a slightly more dynamic composition. I think right now it might feel a little balanced as far as the way that I'm occupying like the surface area of the cover. I think this little moment where we have an overlap here and like shoving this one back kind of adds a little bit of that flavor. I was tempted to move this stuff around, but I think that betrays a little bit how things have been set up too much. So I think maybe it's kind of funny if like the price is over and the, anyway. let's go back over here.
I love how you said that it might be too balanced. So we're going in opposition to some
right.
of the traditional rules we've been talking about.
Yeah, but even, you know, like within like a balanced sort of like spread in like a traditional way, you want some, you know, like hierarchy and sort of dynamic composition. So, you know, kind of like feeling like, you know, if you talk about whatever the rule of thirds, like in photography, or if you talk about like, you know, are you hitting each point? Are you hitting every point? Like, is it dynamic? Is it exciting? This feels empty more so than it feels like purposeful negative space. This is like a trapped space that I think is kind of exciting because you have like this thing that touches the border here and causes tension, but it's also behind something else. But it's not like in, you know, for me, quite there. I can't put my finger. I think as a full image, if the book is open, it's pretty exciting. But
yeah.
Like as an individual cover, I think it deserves more love. But yeah, so kind of just playing here just to get a little bit of an exciting composition with this stuff. Not necessarily, I'm not gonna obsess with it too much for now. I think we can come back to it once we get all the content down. I'm just kind of like optically respecting these guides just like a bit. It's tricky with an image that, you know, because there's a gradient inside of that image, so I could like set my frame to the exact size of the browser window, set it to snap to the guides, and then reopen my window, which I could have done in the time that it took me to explain that.
Right.
But I won't now. So there's a lot of finessing that can happen with the type in here. I think the way that it's breaking, the rag, and maybe some of the treatment. We're gonna come back and sort of finesse some of that stuff and take a look at it, but for now, let's just get sort of everything going.
And so the entire essay at this point has been threaded across three pages, correct?
Yeah, I'm just kind of flowing it through these three pages.
Lindsay Palmer was mentioning how she hasn't seen any bleed or slug settings being used, even mm-hmm. though the intent is print. But actually, I know we discussed a couple days ago yeah. that we're not really even sure if the intent for this is print. It's sort right. of like a digital artifact, live stream.
Mm-hmm.
It will probably go on Behance, maybe get printed. But
right.
I know you did mention slug settings and things like that. So you're aware of that kind of as totally. A need when the print is the actual intent.
Yeah, that's definitely a good point. I think we talked about is this being sort of like, you know, for the sake of the exercise, calling it a publication and going through sort of like the mechanisms of editorial design. Ultimately, if and when I choose to print it, I could sort of reverse engineer those things or, you know, just add a bleed. It wouldn't be too painful. But even so, I think that depending on how, what, the paper, the process, all of those considerations, because I didn't have those ahead of time, I wouldn't even know how to set up my bleed necessarily, because those kinds of specs right. can mean different things. If I'm printing full bleed on, you know, like tabloid size, which could very well be the result for this kind of thing, being the pages 8.5 by 11, then I wouldn't have a bleed, depending on the printer. But for the most part, yeah, like I would need to know how I'm printing it to make those decisions, I guess.
Right.
Which I guess what I'm saying is could be done later.
Just to let everybody know, we'll be doing Chat and Win in 6 minutes or so. So if you have been too shy to say hello, be sure to say hello. Maybe ask us some questions about InDesign, about design in general. Anything goes, really. I'm kind of digging this, just going straight across the middle.
Yeah, I'm into the way that just kind of says, like, I don't care your spread. Like, I don't care the sprint. And then I was wondering what happens if we take it even a step further in this respect of print. I think I mentioned before, like I'm really used to having, you know, like a multi-monitor system. And I kind of tried to make sure the things that I needed were here, but like, I don't know if you guys do this, but you know, it's not reasonable financially for everyone to do this, but in my opinion, like having like a palette monitor and having like your main working monitor, which for me is my laptop, is like off to the side as my palette. And then I have my Wacom tablet, my mouse, and then a gigantic monitor right in front of me. And I used to have like a third monitor vertically off to the side. And sometimes that would just be like a movie. Or
something. The rest of the internet.
Yeah, for sure, the rest of the internet. Something that's distracting me, or like, you know, whatever music I'm listening to, just having that playlist there. But really, like having a main monitor that you're working on, that you can kind of be totally like just whatever you're working on, and then off to your right having, or left, having your palettes, I think, is just like a delightful way of working.
Esther is asked where you find inspiration, which I imagine is such an open.
Right. Good question. I think that for me, I used to be kind of like a junkie with that stuff, and sort of like I was really concerned, not concerned necessarily, but like really invested in making sure I knew what was out there and what was happening. And then the process of going to grad school and being like more personally invested in making, I guess, in a way of like discovery, like more so than fulfilling a brief. And but I started working in a way where I'm looking for form and I'm looking for what means something to me and what I like, versus like trying to find a thing that fulfills what someone else wants. That kind of exhausted the looking, so to speak. And then now that I'm out again, I'm sort of going back to those channels, going back to like my, you know, I used to be huge into a Google Reader, and now I have like the New Reader or whatever. And I didn't look at that for 2 years basically. And now like when I go back, it feels a little bit more refreshing. Hmm. So following feeds, I'm not on Instagram, but people love that. I think that for me, as boring of an answer as that is, but like life, my friends, the process itself. And then, you know, obviously there's a ton of people making amazing work out there, flipping through Behance.
Behance, yes.
So I'm kind of just like jamming on this a little bit. It's kind of like not quite enough text to do what I think could be nice for it. So I'm just kind of like forcing it a little bit right now.
Do you ever find yourself, self-initiating work, and how do you sort of, what's your process there? Do you kind of challenge yourself on a regular basis, or does work itself maybe get in the way of that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that's a good question. I think it's a tricky answer for someone that just left school, because my program was very specifically self-directed, which means that I was initiating all of my work, so to speak, unless I attempted to collaborate, which I did a ton, and, mm-hmm. and other people's voices got in the mix. I'm not totally sure if I answered that question or not. But yeah, I try to, and I think giving priority to what you want and what makes you excited is super important. I'm used to having like, you know, my return all the way on the edge of my keyboard, and I just found out the function return is what that would be, to sort of push text onto the next text box.
Hmm.
If that makes sense?
Yeah, I didn't know that. We've got an interesting question from Nobody. Would you like me to read it to you?
Yeah.
It says, your work reminds me a lot of New Materialism. As a recent MFA, can you recommend any new literature covering design theory and philosophy?
Huge, huge question. I think the honest and sort of like generous answer would be check with me later. And I can send you a super thorough answer. But I think to start, anything on like Verso, the publisher, just go on their site. They're always having sales, buy all those books. Anything on Sternberg Press. I know I say her name wrong, but Hito Sterl is a great writer. Like I recommended yesterday, I think, and he makes a lot of recommendations, but Studio Practice on YouTube, Elliot Earle's channel, he goes through a lot and he drops a lot of names that you guys can sort of follow. I'm reading this book right now. It's actually in my backpack. I forgot what it's called. I'm gonna grab it real quick just to show it on the screen.
Cool. So I'm gonna put a few of these things in the chat pod. The publishers that he mentioned, Verso Books, Sternberg Press, Hito Sterel, which, yeah, we're not entirely sure.
I've learned how to say your name. I went to a lecture and caught like the last 5 minutes because we went to the wrong building. Anyway, this book's pretty good so far. I haven't read the whole thing. It's called Made Up, Designs, Fictions. And it talks about like the idea of like speculative or theoretical, and it talks about like how design always implies different ways to engage things. And then if you just go through the names here, there's a lot of great stuff. Like Ann Burdick is the head of the program at Art Center, and her writing is pretty wonderful. But yeah, this is pretty cool. Okay, so I'm belaboring this a little too much. I'm gonna kind of get it moving.
Oh, want to do a little pillow hype? I see some fireworks.
Let's do it.
Yeah, so we're going to do a little animation, a short intro, and when we come back, we're going to have a random winner selected. So right now, type in the chat, say hello, say hi to your neighbor, say something nice, say something critical, ask a question, and you might be the winner of this pillow in about less than a minute. Hype. Thanks everybody for the hype. Got nice fireworks. Thanks for the short answer, No says, to the question about the literature and philosophy. Katie Drake says, if the person below me gets selected again, I might cry. So who will be the winner of this pillow? The name will resolve on my magic screen soon, and I'll let you know who this is going to today. So thanks for tuning in, everybody. Love this pillow.
Strong pillow.
It is a strong pillow. Got a question. Is there a clipping mask in InDesign like there is in Illustrator?
I've been using the paste into an object. So Option Command V. With that said, is there a clipping mask like there's in Illustrator?
Well, it's interesting because image frames act like
right.
Clipping masks, mm-hmm. in a sense. So if you have an image, it'll always have a rectangular frame around it, and you can sort of bring it in a little bit smaller than your image to act as like a square or rectangular clipping mask. Paste into is a great option. Mm-hmm. Oh, here we go. We got a name. Cullen Brooks, congratulations. You got the pillow today. Everybody congratulate Cullen. Thank you. If you were able to draw a shape of what you wanted to clip into, then you could use the paste into feature, which you can find right clicking, right? And also a keyboard command.
Cool. So I'm going to generate a new spread. So I'm gonna go to my scripts, auto environment, go back up. I'll still speak up a little bit, so I apologize if I mumble. It's my natural state of being.
Apply a clipping path from Photoshop in the object menu. That is cool.
I'm just throwing this in here. We'll work through it later. I'm just kind of going to keep moving. We have like a place to start with some of this stuff. I didn't really resolve the relationship. I think that here, it's not quite there as far as like how it's set up, but the idea of the text being forced to conform to the space left by the image of the work, there's a bit of a thread of like the work came first and the thinking about the work came later, which I think is like, to me, in many ways, a healthier way of working. Like I take turns, I think about things and then I work, which is does not translate well for this process.
Live format.
Yeah, totally. But I think that like, you know, when I'm working, I think I go with like instinct and I let everything that I know inform what I'm doing in like a quiet, you know, like back of my mind way. And then when I stop working, I kind of like print things out. I look at my notebooks and I more aggressively sort of like look into things and try to wrap my head around what it means and what it's trying to do. But I don't think it's really, I think it's just like, I freeze if I try to do that while I'm working, you know?
Right.
And I don't get anything and I'm overly critical and I kind of, it's almost like there's no bad ideas in a brainstorm. There's no bad ideas in a design process in the sense, just try things and then look at them like a viewer, like a person experiencing a thing and try to think whether or not you like it as opposed to like, try to determine your moves ahead of time,
right,
thinking they already know the answers.
Right.
If that makes any sense.
Yeah, well, and yesterday you mentioned something that I thought was really interesting, which is, you know, to push and experiment and to be unafraid and willing to try anything, even if it goes beyond what the brief mm-hmm. might typically suggest or what your own style or sort of limit might dictate, because it's always better and maybe easier to pull back from going that far. And you can take things away and make rational decisions as a process of removal. Mm-hmm. Whereas it's much harder to kind of play it safe up to a certain point or obey all the rules up to a certain point and then need to push it further when things change. And we've definitely been unafraid this week on the live stream. What can did I, we just pull in there?
I'm going through and placing the archive of images.
Okay.
So I just like picked a few things that I think are good places to start as far as like trying to think about what this could mean, and there are different takes on it. The first thing that I pulled in is just an essay, or the did I pull in the essay or the cover of the essay? I pulled in the essay itself. So the an essay called "It's a Tool or Post-Production for the Graphic Designer," and then, you know, the question from earlier, the best answer I could give you, which is kind of an annoying answer because it's kind of an expensive thing and hard to get nowadays, which is Graphic Design Non-Production. It was a book put out by the Walker Arts Center while when Andrew Blauvelt was still there. Now he's the head of the Cranbrook Museum of Art, and it has like tons of writing that was pretty instrumental in how I think about design or the ways that it can open up. It's a really good like day one thing to read as far as like moving into like a new or different thing. And The Gradient, another place to go to that the Walker does. It's like their online publishing platform. Cool, so I have the essay in there. I'm not gonna put the cover as a separate one. This experimental jet set thing, which isn't intended in the way that it happened, but they did, you know, this, they came up with like this sort of format for a shirt through a project that ended up becoming kind of like memetic, I guess.
Yep.
And then everyone, and then people kind of like, you know, ran away with it and made it their own. So there's like all these different examples, but you know, it's like they came up with a system that yielded all these designs unintentionally, I guess, but I don't care if they meant to or not, they did it.
Yeah,
or it happened.
What was the original? It was
the Beatles. It was like a Beatles shirt. Mm-hmm. So yeah, Paul, Ringo, or I forget which order it was on. But yeah, I've seen everything from like the 97 Bulls to, you know, what else is on here. there's all kinds of things. But anyway, so that being
I'm
example,
digging the like four on the floor drum beat, kick, snare, kick,
yeah,
hi-hat,
yeah,
repeat.
Awesome. You're Glennie Hector. It's a robot that spray paints. You guys can look into that.
So the range, the chronological range of these pieces, this archive, is it's pretty expansive, or is a lot of this pretty contemporary in a sense?
I guess relatively contemporary when it comes down to it, but not so on purpose. It's like what came to mind as far as like things that I think are interesting pertaining to making tools that make more tools.
Right.
So it's like not all-encompassing, it's not scholarly, it's not even that smart, it's just like me thinking like, where does my mind go when I think about this stuff? Another project is Metafont, which is sort of like, if I try to explain this, I'm gonna sound real dumb because I don't have all the right language for it. But, you know, it's a typeface that's designed parametrically, I think is the right word to use. As you guys can see, I was Googling how does Behance make money.
I do love the kind of like extra collateral in this.
Yeah, totally.
Piece.
What is a Metapose, Metafont? So Metapose, Metaflop is like a way that makes it like open and easy to engage with. But I think if you're like doing it the right way is just like numbers, and you design a font that way, like the system comes first. So I'm gonna place that on here.
Very interesting. I'm gonna do my best to kind of add the like links or resources to the things that you're talking about into the chat for anybody who's interested.
Another thing, processing, which is a language, and you guys can look into that, but there's like, I think it's pretty common now that if you're in a design class, that one of the things that you go through is like, within a BFA, like at some point, there's a processing project. It opens up like really fun ways, I think, to generate form.
I regrettably missed that in my undergrad, they missed it, I suppose.
Let's make this
one. Thank you, Val, for making the links clickable. So a quick reminder that we'll do portfolio reviews in 45 minutes, 48 minutes actually. So if you are interested, I know we're hoping to specifically focus on editorial-based portfolios. So to the right of the chat pod, there's a portfolio review tab, and there's instructions for how to submit your portfolio for consideration to be reviewed live on today's stream in about 45 minutes. We're gonna pick two, probably spend about, I don't know, anywhere from 7 to 10 minutes on each one. So it's a really, really great opportunity to get some feedback on the portfolios that you have up on Behance. So be sure to submit there.
So I just pasted Pure Data on there. It's a visual programming language to generate music with. I've done all kinds of projects with it. I have a really sort of base level understanding how it works, and the things I've done have been really like entry level. But I made like a generative song that like the input of breathing and like the volume and that like altered like the metrics for the different kinds of modulations within it. So like the speed and the volume at which you breathe or make sound into the microphone dictates what that sort of bigger generative modulating piece of sound would do.
And that happens, I mean, can that happen live? Does it happen live?
Or it was in real time. Yeah. I mocked it up in like a app in like a sort of the beta like trial like app piece of software. So yeah, it was like on my phone and people had their headphones on or whatever, but there's a ton of stuff that you can do, and if you like just YouTube it, all kinds of projects come up, and some people do some really crazy stuff with it. Even like I tried to use it as a rig for effects for my guitar, so like plugging my guitar into my computer and like having it go through Pure Data to like modulate and stuff, and it's cool because it's all kind of like, it sounds like you're playing through a toaster because it doesn't really like handle sound in a pretty like rich way. All above my pay grade, not sure exactly what that means, but everything ends up sounding super like digitally, which is cool, especially going into like, you know, like a tube amp and then like getting like a rich sound.
And then
back.
It amplifies it, yeah.
Cool, so the last one that I'm pasting in here is like Stony Island, which is a Theaster Gates project, which I referenced in the writing. And a lot of his work is about like funding things in like an interesting and open way, and sort of like, so for Stony Island, which used to be a bank, he took apart the dividers in the bathroom, which were marble, and carved like banknotes out of it, which he sold, and that funded the project to turn that space into like this open art space. So that kind of thinking to me is pretty exciting.
Wow.
And I like that photo best. So I'm gonna paste that in here. Cool, and then we're gonna come back to all of this.
Stony Island Arts Bank.
Yeah, in Chicago.
Wow. This is kind of an interesting branding system that they have on the left. Well, I suppose that's branding, but kind of modular.
Yeah, that'd be fun if on one of the UI like versions of this live stream if they dissected that. I think it's pretty interesting. It's kind of disorienting in a really fun way. I think once you post the link, you guys can look at it too. Cool, so we have all these images on here. And then, so,
Matthews is asking, this work is for web?
Yes and no.
Yes and no is the answer. It's sort of hybrid media. It is a live stream. It is a working InDesign document currently. Potentially, well, it will likely go on Behance.
Right, yeah.
Probably as a mix of the live stream and the spreads themselves in some form. Ryan Nelson says, the last Whole Earth catalog, that's the jam. Found that in his grandpa's garage and felt like he never needed the internet for information again.
Yeah, that's wonderful. That's great. That's a find. I wonder what that's worth.
And Dennis is asking, can we kind of recap what is going on currently right now?
So I'm kind of like in the between, or between step, or I'm in the middle of a step of edit. I'm adding a caption for each one of these things after I've placed the images for sort of this archive. And I am about to do what you guys probably could guess I'm gonna do, which is process the images that we just placed for the archive. Because you already know where they are, and there's a caption there that's just enough to get some Googling going, but not quite enough to tell you anything without you having to Google, which is, I think, a nice place to be in. Because I'm not here to give answers.
And what's the process for processing? Oh, we're gonna go into Photoshop.
Yeah, I think we're gonna go through Photoshop, and we're gene go back to that same Gaussian blur move, just enough so that the image informs something, but not enough to retain any of the actual information.
Like that. No. And will these replace the images?
Yeah, I'm saving right over them.
Saving them right over, yeah. So, yeah, just to recap, this section of the publication that Lucas is working on right now is intended as an archive. So it's a container for other artists and designers' works and products and applications that relate to your understanding and interest in generative design. Mm-hmm. So within this publication, this is sort of a collection of that. And we hope that you read and saw the images as they were before they were Gaussian blurred, because they're going to come back in.
Right. I think it's like we're trying to, this thing is like a memory of this experience that we're going through. So I think that like showing you the image and giving you the reference is enough so that this new image now that we've processed is a memory of that image that we saw once. And then if you want to go back and know more about that, you have to actually like Google the thing that's going to be on the page, which you will have access to. And that also like establishes this thing of like, there's a group of people, there's a set of people, which is everyone that's on the chat and watching right now and everyone that's in the room that have that memory, or anyone that watches the video later. So we can kind of go through it now and just see that it gives you very little other than like a slight memory of the image that we saw before and a place to start to try to figure out what it was in the first place. I kind of really like this one. I don't know if I'm just me fetishizing Gaussian blur, but I really like or right now, for whatever reason, I'm really into it. Like right here, I think that's really nice, how it's just like, you know, there's a little bit of movement mm-hmm. of gray, so you just get a little bit of the box right there. This one is really nice for me too, because it's like, I wouldn't draw this, like it's just too complex and strange of a subtle kind of like, yeah. This one's nice too, because it kind of feels like there's a, it's behind this image.
It's also kind of, to me, it's really subtly referencing the colors that have already come into the project. They're sort of the cool mm-hmm. and a little bit of like green.
Yeah, maybe it's a good place for us to go back to and kind of just go through the whole thing for a second. Yeah, so we come in kind of hot. There's like a lot of noise and sort of contrast and different kinds of graphic moves. So I don't know what to expect once I see these two things. And we kind of abandon this language, I guess, for the most part. Moving on, this kind of glitchy thing. But anyway, we come into here and kind of break down what the project is in a very loose way, which I think is exciting. And then we introduce the scripting, and then we annotate the scripting, and we jump into the intro, come in hot with some color, which I didn't feel sure about before, but now I'm kind of into, just because it's such a change. And we build onto that experience, we build onto that intro with a really convoluted system of words. I can't really call it like a paragraph because it's almost illegible, but then that kind of gets digested, so to speak, and is contained within these words inside of this sentiment, which I think is like a really sort of like good direct way to address what I was trying to say before. And then we're here, so we'll work through this. I think I just kind of threw it on that page, but we have some text that goes through what we're trying to do, and three images which sort of reference the process. Then we go into the archive that we just worked through, and boom, that's our whole thing so far.
And you think that sort of like shift in, mm-hmm. well, the layout, I mean, the frame is consistent, but that shift from the text and image in the essay portion
right.
to the archive is, it's almost enough to delineate that as a new, it is enough to delineate
yeah.
that as a new section, but you're not thinking that you need like a page to
I think
call
it'd
that
be,
out.
I think it'd be fun to have a little bit of a moment to introduce that stuff. So I think that maybe that's what we'll go into next. We have a little bit of like this intro here. So maybe it makes sense to try and repurpose some of this. Like this is a move to do an intro here, so I think maybe the way to go is we have this. We're gonna guess what? Take a screenshot of that. I'm gonna pull this into. I think what we did before is we, boom.
Bitmap.
We bitmapped it, and then we're gonna go back to grayscale, back to RGB, and we're gonna.
Claire Cross says, a la la, I love this work, so different.
Thanks, Claire. This is a thing.
It's, you know.
But I just have to.
Perspective. New perspective.
Yeah. Yeah, maybe I do want it to blow out like that a little bit. We'll see what happens. I'm going to merge those. So there's no going back. Sometimes I do that. So I just, I mean, there is going back, but in my head, it's like, okay, cool. Now I have to make this work.
Right.
As opposed to like go back and, you know, reinvent whatever that was. And we're gonna gradient map it and maybe go for a new Ninja Turtle. I don't know. I guess we don't have That's kind of hot.
Do we need a reference chart? Ninja Turtle?
Yeah.
Pantone?
Well, I was going to say, well, yesterday we had a challenge with the 90s, yeah. And that informed what we're doing. Today's portfolio. So maybe I'm just going to go with like some of these preset. This one's kind of wild, but it has too much of the colors that we've seen before. I think maybe this one is nice just because it's like a new, it's a little bit outside of what it was. And I guess with color, you can always go back and refine your palette, but the nature of this thing right now, I think for me, there can be movement throughout. So let's just go back. Actually, let me.
With a recap. Some people are asking for another recap. Who just joined us, which by the way, hi Joel, thanks for joining us from Ontario. Claire's recap is take anything, mix it, destroy it, rescue it, paste it, and design it.
I'll take it. Yeah, so I think that it's really all about thinking about the way in which you work and why you work that way, and thinking about what it means to work the way that you work. And if there's other ways of working that are more closely aligned with what you believe in as far as design or making or producing culture goes. So I think some people can call, you know, people call it a lot of different things. Depending on the context, it can be, you know, like decolonizing the design process. It could be querying the design process. I think for me, it's just like making it a little bit more personal. I think those, you know, all of that is really important, but without getting into too big of a conversation, I think it's just sort of like questioning these, native answers in design, which, you know, come out of very specific traditions in modernism, which are really strict for a reason. And maybe you don't agree with that reason, so why would you design that way? Cool. And then I think we're gonna be super boring and we're just gonna write essay. We're kind of referencing the system we saw before, but letting it have enough movement and change, and maybe boom.
What is needed to change the mode to bitmap?
Mode to bitmap. Oh, you got to go grayscale first.
First, and then.
Yeah. Because it needs zeros and ones.
Yep.
And there's, you know, when you bitmap, there's all the different sort of ways of bitmapping. I haven't gone through that too much for this, but I think you guys, if you guys are interested in that process, then maybe playing through with that a little bit. It's pretty nice because there's like, you know, you can use a pattern, you can use like some of the set patterns, you can like make an illustration and bring it in and do it that way. So it's pretty open. Maybe what we need here. Is we need to
Colin likes the essay overlay.
Yeah, I'm kind of into it. It's looking a little hip right now. It's kind of bumming me out.
It's too hip.
Looking a little like from the internet. You know, a little cool. And you know, why would you be cool when you can be hot? You know what I'm saying?
We do have kind of the heat map thing going on in the back.
Right, I guess. Yeah, well, then maybe it makes sense. Maybe it's referential, right? Maybe it's doing that on purpose without telling me. I'm not sure if I like what I just did. You know what? Commit to it.
All about commitment.
commit to. Maybe this goes right over the essay. Maybe it doesn't. Okay. Cool. So that's right now our essay title. So let's give our archive a title. Now, where do we start with for the archive title? Maybe we just take our archive window. Let me take a screenshot of that. So as far as version control, keeping things organized, you know, I haven't like, you know, done any of that.
Have we saved? the last live stream.
We've been saving a little bit.
Yeah. One of the last live streams, we were doing some heavy duty compositing, and the save happened at the end. Luckily, nothing happened.
Yeah, it's terrifying.
Always a good reminder.
Yeah. So we're going to go through the same process here. So mode, grayscale, mode, bitmap, let it flatten. So right now I have custom pattern, and as you guys can see, it's this, which just means that we end up with vertical lines. Right, so everything is built out of this little.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah, fine.
Which, you know, doesn't really translate into too much once we go through the Gaussian blur, but it's just like that mix yielded something interesting the first time we tried it, so I haven't questioned it. Maybe I will control the Gaussian blur just slightly. Is that betraying the process?
No. The fact that you just said it makes it part of the process.
I just think that maybe a little bit of like movement, just a little bit, just like that, a little something before, and then we can like bring a little bit more of that into play here.
Actually, I think make a custom Photoshop action for this process.
Yeah, I guess I could have done that from the beginning.
Right?
Yeah,
grayscale to bitmap,
mm-hmm.
back to grayscale, back to RGB, right. Gaussian blur, add a gradient map, and then what is it? Blending mode here?
Yeah, this is just the gradient map, yeah. And I think that's all. That's it. That's all it takes.
Wow! Total.
That looks bananas. You know, maybe what we need is a little bit of a perp, a little perp in there. I'm not totally sure what I'm looking for right now. I'm just kind of moving it around until it's at a place where I think it's exciting. That doesn't look like, I mean, it kind of looks like an x-ray, like you're going through the, like, security. Oh, which, by the way, on my way over here, TSA looked at my license, looked at me, and was like, got a big beard now, huh?
Wow, that was the verbatim?
Yeah, no, but, like, smiling, like, I was like, you know, like, yeah, and he's like, I like it. And he
gave me my okay, head. I'm like, oh, sorry, I could have like, gone, like,
yeah,
another direction.
No, he was, like, super chill. I was like, oh, I like it, yeah, good beard. I'm like, I don't know. People in my life don't like it as much. yeah. All right. That's the sound InDesign makes, you get if you guys are not familiar.
Yeah, that came directly from his computer.
Yeah. Cool. We're gonna boom boom boom. Do I want this one? Yes.
want to know a trick I learned about this?
So you can
mm-hmm. change the color without actually yeah. highlighting the text if you just have the text box selected.
Right.
And then go to the color, the same fill menu,
yeah.
and then just select the T right there.
Oh, right.
Oh, you
yeah,
probably
yeah.
knew that. I was like so amazed when yeah, I learned yeah. that, and I am not ashamed to admit that I learned yeah. it maybe like a month ago.
Yeah, and I could have had all of them selected.
Right.
Right. Yeah, I'm just going through there. And boom, boom, boom. Yeah, pro move.
Yeah, well, InDesign's user interface is sort of like a airplane cockpit, you know. There's... Once you get to know all the yeah. things, you get yeah. to know all the things, yeah. but it can be extremely, I would almost argue, maybe more yeah. daunting than Photoshop's, right off the bat.
I learn random things, and then wow, that's pretty late for me to learn. And randomly I'll learn something. I remember like sizing something from the middle, and then every time someone asks me for the shortcuts, I just have to like
yeah.
do this in my head, because I don't know, I can't say them out loud. I just kind of know, you know, like resizing from the center, like Option Command C to like reset the size of a text box to the text, like that stuff. And then I go to Illustrator and I do that, and it gives me like it thinks I'm trying to do something entirely different.
Yeah,
and that bones me out.
I think the scariest one is in Photoshop, Alt Command. Oh wait, now I've got to do it again. Like to undo, so Command Z, but Alt Command Z to kind of keep undoing. But if you do that in Illustrator
mm-hmm.
with Alt, it asks you if you want to revert to the original document state, which is really scary because often I'm working in both kind of like at the same time. And
that's terrifying.
Yeah, we might talk to Adobe about that.
I wonder if we know someone at Adobe.
Yeah, does anyone know anybody at Adobe?
Anyone at Adobe? Cool. Boom, boom, boom.
So I think from here on, we're gonna call all keyboard command, you know, if you have to kind of like do this and imagine what yeah. keyboard shortcut is, that's called the claw. I mean, whatever position
like
your hands make is the claw.
Mm-hmm.
That's dark.
Yeah, I'm kind of tempted to not throw an outline on there, just to let the archive get lost. But let's take a look. So we have the cover, we have stretch type, but it's like in a different kind of way. Which I'm cool with. Let it live. Then we have this intro, white outlined, black. It's kind of fitting to the frame all the way to the margins.
Are you kind of just looking at the consistency and continuity
yeah.
and determining where it functions best to break that and where it
yeah,
makes
yeah.
sense to keep it?
Just what we have so far.
Yeah.
Just looking at what we have so far. I kind of wonder if maybe this hits the center here, because it kind of dissects that S in half. I'm not convinced. Not convinced. But then I kind of wonder too if I can just cheat and have it end in the middle of that E. Kind of into the for now, so I'm just going to let that ride. So this one is a little different because he has images in here. We're going to let it live like that for a minute. And then go over here. Let's see if we like that better. I think we kind of like that better. But I think I want to see the essay up here, so let's bring that back up.
Oh yeah, that's interesting. It's almost like a little thumbnail preview for where you just came from.
Yeah, now I feel silly because we kept you. Oh, we can just take it again. I saw someone posted there's a shortcut to getting that without having to press spacebar. I think they said it was Shift Command F3 or something. But
right.
I didn't entirely catch it. So
I don't even have function keys on this MacBook
right.
anymore. So
yeah, is that legacy?
Function keys are
it's a legacy.
Legacy.
Yeah. So I'm gonna go ahead and throw that right in here. So we still have the images, right? We got them back because we have them. Well, no, actually, no, because they're blurred in here too.
Well.
Break my own rules too much. Yeah, I do. But not this one. The sets have always, the set of like environmental data has been in the same color through one spread. I've gone back from white and black depending on whether I wanted to get some legibility or not. So I don't want to break that just for this one. But I think this is nice with this on top. Then that makes me kind of tempted to throw that one in the back too. So we have a little bit of like, the set stays together. And I mean, I might as well hit those guides. I'm not too worried about it. But since I have them, since we're here.
Since they're available.
Yeah, get a little bit of like a sense of consistency throughout. So let's just go back through real quick and take a look at, we have the intro.
We got somebody asked if they missed another selfie, but I don't think that's happened yet.
That hasn't. There was word in the studio that people wanted more selfies.
I think we get selfie hype in the chat?
Because I think Gus was plugged in. I mean, he was eating last time, so he wasn't.
That's right. Gus bought. Ryan is asking if you beatbox because of the sound effects.
If I beatbox, I will not right now. No, I don't.
Oh, I do, but...
Yeah. No, that I don't at all. But I could, and I should, but I won't. Thoughts on David Carson? A lot. But I won't get into it right now. Cool energy, you know? Doing his thing, has his own language. I think maybe a little derivative of some of the other stuff that was going on at the same time. You know, there's some hype of, like, maybe directly ripping people off, but I don't know because I wasn't there. So I'll just go with, like, good energy, and there's some good vibes in there, and like the Surf magazine stuff, I think it's cool. Not top five for me in influence, but I think good energy. Yeah.
You have a top five influence that you can recite in beatbox?
Yeah, I'm just gonna rap it now. I don't, and I think if I did, it would be more so people in my life than,
right,
you know, like anyone that I've encountered in that way. Though there's definitely been moments where I've seen things and they've had like a major influence on me. I have to say this, I keep looking at this and it's kind of like just how like much it looks like a certain kind of making that it just, it's looking way too hip for me and that's kind of bumming me out. But I'm just gonna let it ride. Do I wanna do that or is that just a bummer? Do we lose the image entirely? Do we care? Maybe that tension is more interesting than that tension. Yeah.
It's more tense, yes.
Yeah, let's leave it there. Cool. Oh, yeah, I was going through the... So, we're back to intro, essay, archive. It's pretty consistent, all things considered.
Yeah, it's nice.
So I guess we'll let it ride like this for now. Let's see. I think we should probably revisit the essay then. There's kind of like a cool thing about this being right in the middle. So I wonder if we can just kind of, let me see where I'm hitting. Oh, am I hitting anywhere too special? No, I'm kind of, maybe I'll center it. Or I won't.
And so are you using the terminal screenshot as a reference point for these other pages and then you'll remove it?
Which is kind of like a super lazy and not like, you know, smart and sustainable way of doing things. And ultimately, if we were getting this file print ready, we would revisit these things. I think there's a whole process of getting files print ready, which is all about like the nuance and specific sort of moments where even go beyond the design decisions, but they're just like about getting, you know, is everything snapping and all that stuff. So we're not definitely not gonna get there with this, but I just want to get the general ideas out there. And I think you just have to trust me that I'm going to finesse it later. Finesse.
Penis.
Yeah.
Thank you, Rachel and Ryan, for joining us.
Yeah, so if you guys have noticed, I have like two boxes going on here. I have like the box that's containing the image, and then I drew another box to throw the text wrap on so that I have a little bit more control of where exactly it stops without having to cut off the gradient or whatever. Not like the smartest and most like, you know, sustainable way of working necessarily either, but just kind of like a quick way to sketch these general ideas out. With that said, you know, I started from the place of having the terminal to make some decisions, but I don't think I'm gonna totally entirely go for that. I just kind of want to make this contend with the image for this one, but I don't want to necessarily make it all about that.
What are you looking for in terms of making it contend?
Just like, you know, forcing it to respond to it. So if you guys remember, I pushed it. I had like the, it's not a hard return, but it's like the hard enter that pushes the text onto the next box, so I can make this box bigger without changing where the next paragraph starts. Mm-hmm.
So do you just do that once and it automatically brings everything below it to the start of the next box, matter what?
As soon as I started ragging, I realized that we're not gonna get to rag. I'm just gonna make broader moves than that. But I do think that, you know, design can be a studio model which tempers self-reflection with connection and community building. I kind of want to let that moment sing a little bit, let it shine.
I thought you were ad-libbing that. You were actually reading what was.
Oh, yeah.
I was like, wow.
I was reading that. So I made a new spread here, and I'm going to bring it all the way back. And, you know, I don't know. I'm not in a hurry. You guys are not in a hurry. So let's let... let's milk this a little bit more and kind of introduce some like slowness to this composition. And by slowness, I just mean like in the pacing of this like super dense thing. You know, maybe that's doing too much. Yeah, so, you know, like, a lot of these moves that we've done have been kind of about, like, energy and movement and, like, all this stuff. But it doesn't have to be. Sometimes it can be about, like, nuance and typography. And this is not the quietest spread I've ever made. But just having that moment, I think, is kind of nice. So we're coming from, you know, we have the essay, we have the text starts, and I think that, you know, this would deserve a little bit more love, getting that rag right and having, you know, a little bit more nuance, but then having like a little bit of a moment where we get to meditate on an idea and sort of like see what it's about for a second. So I think I want to do that again. Let's take a look at where else. And here's what I mentioned to you guys, the Esther Gates quote. Make the thing that makes, he wants to make the thing that makes the thing. There's a way in which making the thing is cool, but to be able to make the thing that makes the thing is super cool, which is a super cool quote.
Super cool quote is super cool.
Yeah, just like you said it in the corniest way possible, which, you know, I have to respect. So my script generates that spread at the end every time, so I just have to bring it back to where it belongs.
Got about 10 minutes until portfolio reviews.
Woo!
I'm excited.
Cool. So I'm gonna milk it a little bit more. There's one more quote that I wanna bring in there. The meaning of our work is connected to how it's made, not just concepted. So maybe I want this spread to contain more than one, so I'll do this for now, see how it feels, try it on. Maybe light ragging just to get a little bit more of an interesting shape out of those things. And there's one more quote in here. And this is a line from that essay that I brought up to you guys. And there's like some things in here that we could like, you know, address and handle like titles of things and stuff, and we're just not going to get to that right now. But one more quote, a new phase of maturation for design's relationship to technology, when the definition of design extends to the creation of new tools that enable and empower others to design. So I think that's all about, like, you know, inclusion and sort of looking at the gatekeeping that happens in design and how mastery of tools and even a BFA can be, or, you know, the style in which you design, those things can serve as gates that keep some people in and some people out. Mm-hmm.
Selfie time?
Can you do it?
Can you fold that into the
100%?
Okay.
You can always fold that in. I don't think you guys can hear that. It's like a dog whistle kind of alarm, but our selfie siren just went off.
It's part of GusBot's feature set.
Yeah, which means that we
freshly updated.
You have to take a selfie right now.
Should we wait for a
Maybe he'll come in right. Okay, we're gonna wait. We're gonna wait till everybody in the studio's back to take a second.
The siren was a false
alarm. False alarm, actually.
Yeah, I'm gonna take this one out and kind of milk this a little bit more. Just let this kind of do this.
And I just got a note from Paco on the teleprompter that says, "Wait for me."
I know if I do this without anything selected, all my next box might X out. But if I do this, then the next box that I make will obey that same thing, which I haven't done before in this one. But from now on, I don't think I'll make any more text boxes. But better late than never.
So Daniel Kiso is asking, what are they doing? We are making... what aren't
good
we
question.
Doing?
Good question. If anyone can figure it out, please let us know. I'm just kind of working through some of the quotes in here and letting them sing a little bit, giving them a little bit more space and time, and sort of slowing down the process, the pace of the proverbial publication. I think that we're gonna do it like this.
We're gonna get Voodoo Val in the selfie symbolically. Find something purple. Maybe that Lysol canister up there. How does that work, Val?
Yeah, so especially I think the type in this whole thing needs the most love still. But let's just do a quick run through to see what we have going on here.
Can you explain the keyboard command that you just did enter this presentation mode?
Shift W, presentation mode. So we have the cover, we have the welcome screen. Welcome spread.
Welcome screen.
Thanks for joining us.
Love it.
Kind of breakdown of what we're working with here. Introduction to the scripting. Breakdown of the scripting. It's a generous way to describe what I did there. Breakdown of the scripting. Intro. Me rambling. Breakdown of me rambling. Introducing the essay. And then we have the essay starting. I pulled that quote to the beginning. So we have that quote, and then we go into it. First paragraph, a couple quotes. Second paragraph, another quote. Third paragraph, retain a plural voice. Boom, archive. And from the archive, we go through the projects. Boom. That's it. And now we're gonna our last spread is gonna be a selfie, and then the back cover.
All right.
I'm gonna go through it fast again, so maybe we can see some movement in the animation. Can you guys see that? It's looking right here.
Oh yeah.
It doesn't happen in order because I tried to respect the process in which we were working, and I made the spreads in the order we needed them, and not in the order they're laid out in the magazine. But if you look at that, it just kind of he blinks one time, and then it just kind of looks like he's freaking out.
Yeah, that's kind of. Yeah. We're gonna do a selfie. And then 5 minutes to portfolio reviews.
You guys can see that I shift command W for me opens up Alfred, and then I type in whatever I need. But
I remember Alfred.
Yeah.
Parker's gotta fix his jacket.
Get the outfit right.
It's gotta look fresh.
Yeah, spotlight's gone so good that you don't need Alfred anymore. But
okay, we want everybody in the audience to also smile because you're gonna be part of this selfie right here.
We should make
here.
A boy band.
There we go.
Nice.
Wonderful.
Oh, can we redo it? I forgot to put Val in there.
Oh, Val's. Yeah. We need to do it with Val.
Are you going to do it with, the purple Voodoo Val?
That was an early.
That's good. That's excellent.
Premature firing of the shutter.
Yeah, was that countdown? Is it a countdown?
I don't think so. I think it went 3-1-0.
Three shot, which is, there we go.
Thank you, everybody, for bearing with us through that.
I'm actually surprised I can pull that straight in here. From
photo booth?
Yeah.
All right, photo booth.
Guess what? I'm going to stretch that right there.
We got 3.5 minutes until we do some portfolio reviews. It's going to be sweet.
Oh, I'm excited about it.
Yeah, we've got them ready. I've got them ready. Just go ahead and pull them up.
And then one more. From here, I'll just make a new page. Boom. Back cover. Time. Boom.
Beautiful.
So I'd say right now, actually, I think that these are pretty successful, the sort of intro pages. I think like there's a system and they're sort of like, they fit together and they're impactful and they're bright. I think that they could be pushed further. I feel like it's just a little known, especially this one just feels like a little like from the internet in a way that I think it could be more.
I'm trying to imagine like the piece of type of work that you are referencing. You keep saying that.
I think that if you spend enough time on, I don't know, just it's a little like, there's something about it, it's a little too cool, a little too, I don't know. I just got to work through that. I'm not really sure what that means. But from as far as like composition, hierarchy, color, like all those kinds of things, I think it's like, what I'm happiest with right now is like these intro moments. It's like the more exciting sort of design moments for me. I'm really into this whole section. I think it's funny in the way that it's sort of like a memory of a thing, and it's like you can't totally see in the same way that memories you don't totally like have a grasp on or whatever, and that's kind of interesting to me, and there's like enough movement between the pages, and it just kind of gives you like a place to start as far as like a thing to Google. I think it's nice. I had no idea what was going to happen here, and I think it's kind of interesting. It feels a little goofy, which is cool, but also I'm not totally sure. I don't know what else I would do here, because I feel like anything onto it would be like kind of betraying the process of it, but you know, ultimately when you're done and you're turning something in or when you're making something, no one knows how you got there. So you have to decide whether or not that matters, you know? I think this moment is nice. I think I'm kind of glad that it happens alone, that we don't have this sort of like a, again. I'm glad I kept this here more so for the memory of going through that process and kind of like as an ode to how we got here. I'm pretty happy with the cover. I think this is interesting as an introduction. It kind of opens things up. The thing that needs the most work for sure, I think if I was getting this, you know, ready, is the essay section. I think that, you know, there's just some really basic sort of typographic things that I would start to look at, as far as like how the movement and like compositionally, and you know, I think that this is the moment where I think it would need the most amount of time, like,
right,
just because I would just play with it and then undo everything and then like make iterations and then go back and but you know, for the sake of the exercise, I think it's pretty nice. I think this is probably the most successful spread of these. It's a combination of being disorienting and kind of broken, but also having like, it's pretty rigid in the sense where you have like, you know, text is hitting pretty consistently in these spots. There's like this moment where this image lines up with the centered image, and then you have like sort of this, you know, caption lines up with a column here. So there's like, you know, this elusive kind of grid is being reinstated here. So you have a little bit of something to hold on to, but also you're just kind of like rejecting it in a pretty like aggressive way and having this image, which really, you know, like the thing that we did, you know, is the thing, not the words about the thing. And the words are really like just around the thing, and the words are being forced to contend with the thing more so than fuel the thing into existence. And I think that sort of does that, or at least it was a good jumping off point to get to a place where the composition is kind of interesting.
And you do plan on actually maybe making these refinements, kind
yeah,
of
setting everything
up, and
totally. So I'll revisit. I think the thing that will change the most is going to be like this text section. I'm not totally sure what will happen. I like the idea of keeping this, you know, sort of like white space, or having a little bit of this white space, letting things breathe a little bit. But I do think it needs a little bit of love getting somewhere. So I think from this point on, I'll spend the most time getting that together, and then it'll make its way onto Behance, and you guys can tell me what you think.
Awesome. Sounds great. So we're going to review some portfolios right now. We've got two pulled up, so thank you everybody that actually submitted your portfolio. It's a shame that we're not able to like get to them all. But let's go ahead and take a look at the first one. And I hope he has not left for lunch already, because he said he was going to earlier, but Ryan Ford's portfolio, graphic designer from... Oh wait, we have to do an intro. Want to go to space?
Let's go to space.
Okay, we're going to space, and then we'll come back and do some portfolio reviews. Welcome back. Ugh. We have to come up here to do portfolio reviews. The air is a lot better. So, Ryan Ford, are you in the house? We're not sure. He said he was hungry and had to get lunch. I'm actually not sure where in the world is lunch right now. Hawaii? Not sure. But let's take a look at his portfolio. Ryan is a self-described graphic designer from Vancouver, British Columbia, a craftsman and artivist. Primary mastery in Photoshop, Illustrator, as well as working in InDesign, aspiring to better his craft, develop his skills, grow as a designer. Let's connect. Okay, cool. So let's do like an overall impression, I think, because this is obviously most everyone's first glance at your work. What are you thinking?
I can tell right off the bat that he puts a lot of attention into the framing of the project. So everything, it feels like every image is sort of, it's built for the showcasing the project, not so much cataloging and sort of, you know, these are not like scans of the publication, or they're not like working, you know, they're not an export, a PDF export of the publication. They're, you know, composited images to sort of like celebrate the projects more so. I think that energy is good, and the consistency is nice. There's a few different ways. Yeah, I mean, his work kind of goes in a lot of different directions.
Yeah.
But I think that it's pretty consistent that he like spends some energy trying to frame the project in a way and get it ready for showing.
Right. So do any one of these projects sort of stand out to you as something that you want to explore further, just based on this framing?
Breakthrough. I'm curious about that Broken Beauty project, just because I think there's like the most color movement.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually the one that maybe has the least framing in it. So I overheard Michael say in the last portfolio review that, you know, he gave the advice of adding something up top, just because Behance used to have its sort of description up top, and now it's like at the bottom. So like, if you have a project that kind of like demands a little bit of like contextualizing or framing, then maybe doing that is a good idea. Yeah, so I think this one is all about, so is that process, or?
It looks like experimentation.
Cool.
The final thing, so.
Oh, and it's kind of like showing us how the final.
Oh, here's some process, yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, these kind of builds are always really interesting to me. I think it's always a kind of a nice touch, and always like a little extra too. I mean, like the thing ultimately in a lot of portfolios stands on its own, but to kind of break down the process, however you do it, is always, I always appreciate when designers and artists are able to do that. It just sort of.
Yeah, I think it all depends too on the context of like where you're showing your work, and I think if you use Behance more so like a community kind of like showing your work to other designers, and kind of then that totally makes sense for me as far as like having like a inside baseball kind of conversation about design, and people can ask questions like what happened there, and you know, so that's pretty cool.
Cool. How about anything else? You can go back up to the top if you want to.
Yeah, I'm curious to see some of that publication work you have up top. So we could, first one is like, I guess, an illustration for a magazine. Also, this is, so these are illustrations. So let me look at those real quick. Yeah, those are nice. There's a lot of, there's a lot of information in them, but they don't feel too crowded, right? I think, I mean, I can see sort of like one more step into like establishing maybe even like not simpler necessarily, but tightening up compositionally what happens within that. I think the center one to me is like the most powerful one, just because that the plate is kind of like, it's like a sub container within. So there's like the framing of the silverware and the bowl of soup or the tea or I'm not totally sure what that
is. Yeah, it looks like maybe a bowl on top of a plate.
But within the plate, there's like a nice little composition that. There's the larger shape. So that one's looking pretty good. The color is really nice throughout. But yeah, these are pretty nice.
Yeah.
I wonder if, you know, especially too, if it's all about the illustration within the publication. That's a good spread, but I mean, we could see them bigger, I guess, right? I don't know.
Within, are you in this Behance experience or like in the actual design?
Yeah, because like here, in the spread, they're pretty much the same size as we're seeing them.
Out. Oh, I see, yeah.
Yeah, so like I don't see a reason to see them twice in the same scale. Like if you were to show them twice, maybe make a little like 2-1-2 grid.
Yeah, yeah.
And kind of like, let me get in there a little bit.
Yeah, potentially get playful with it too, in the same way that these illustrations use layering and kind of break the frame to give you some form and dynamics. Like you could almost, potentially if you had the time, I know this takes additional work, think about your Behance project like it's an extension of this project. So like bring the colors in, obviously, you know, some of that tone and everything is still here, but the way that you frame your Behance project can actually take cues from the work itself. And I always love, as an art director, I love seeing those kind of really integrated. And I know they take a lot of time, especially after you're finished with a project. Like maybe the last thing you want to do is keep, like, you need a break. But,
yeah, totally.
But always a good idea to kind of give a total package on Behance if you're going to put it up there. How about anything else?
Or the plant-based protein packaging. It's like a pretty different kind of project.
Yeah. Oh, this is interesting. I was kind of fooled.
Yeah, yeah, totally. I was waiting for you. So cool. Is there a breakdown? So he did the packaging and also the sort of ads and website and everything?
Or? Yeah, art direction, branding, graphic design. It seems cool. Like that, but...
Yeah, I think that the way in which it showcases is pretty clear. I do think that maybe having a little bit of a reference to the frame of the site would clarify, because I like you, I kind of, as we were going through it, I got lost of whether these were like several images within Behance or if it was actually like a desktop. So I think, you know, and I've done this so many times where I take like a screenshot of the browser and then I just kind of fake mop things into it and
sort of
like stretch it. And I've even stretched like, you know, like the size of, I've stretched iPhones to be like squares or like really long because I think it's funny.
Just yeah,
you know, because you have like an Instagram, like, you know, square image. I just I'll turn the iPhone into a square.
Nice.
And I'm alone thinking it's funny, but you know. Oh, I saw, hi, Dad.
Is that your real dad?
Yeah, he was on there.
Oh, nice.
He's gone.
He's gone. Okay.
He's gone. Yeah. I'm sure he's still watching though.
Okay, let's maybe take a look at one more.
Yeah, this is very different, torn away from everything else. It's looking pretty wild.
Oh, wow.
Buried treasure. So this is a movie? There's like a blood spiral around a skull that's out of control.
Okay, this is cool. Like a macro view of like the entire workflow, like starting in dimension, so creating some 3D objects, putting them in this scene. Well, yeah, it looks like most of the composition was done there, and then just all the typographic elements added on top.
Yeah, I think, you know, everything has been pretty, like, thoroughly taken care of as far as, like, how am I going to frame this project? There's, like, a lot of attention to that process. I'm not totally sure what he wants out of life as far as, like, I was talking to Ryan, like, you know, like, what are you trying to do here? Like,
right.
I think, you know, for the most part, he's just using Behance as a container for all of his projects, and then each individual project is being, like, catered to the kind of content that it has. So, like, that movie poster project, like, the whole thing is kind of, like, dark and, you know, like, and I don't know what I think about that as far as, like, looking at that project and then looking at a different project that's, like, protein, like, plant protein, and then the framing of the project is, like, open and, like, meaning like his portfolio itself or sort of the way that he's handling the framing within Behance alters based on projects.
Right. Yeah. And this is always kind of an interesting thought for me as an art director at Adobe. We're constantly looking at Behance to find artists, designers, animators, photographers to work with, to collaborate with. And, there's always kind of a put a tension between like if you feel like you can do a lot of things and do you put them all in there. Oftentimes sometimes the project calls for like looking for somebody who does something focused and does that really well. So I don't disagree with the idea of putting like a range of work, but it is pretty interesting to to see that within, you know, two rows we go all the way from like dark kind of creepy movie poster to a lot lighter open, and you know, that's Ryan, that's your choice in terms of curatorial. I would always suggest, like, what is the work that you want to do most?
Right.
And then highlight that, because that's going to, somebody says, I like that, they're likely going to be contacting you to do something similar to what they see.
Yeah, I remember hearing that advice when I was in undergrad. Like, I remember hearing the opposite advice in undergrad, which was like, you should maybe do like a digital, like a web design, something like round out your portfolio. And then I'm like, well, but what if I don't want to do that? Which I, and when you're in undergrad, you should just do all the things, because you don't know. Like, I didn't know. Mm-hmm. Everything that you think you know, you don't.
Yeah.
So just try the things. But I think, like I said, like that also depends on how he's using Behance. I think if you're using it as like sort of like a platform to engage with other designers and kind of showcase what you're working on and see what they think, then it makes sense to include, you know, all the things that you're interested in talking about and getting seen. But if you're using it as a platform to kind of like showcase your portfolio from like a like professional like hiring perspective, then maybe a little bit of curation, maybe like focusing on the things that you want to be doing and showcasing those skill sets. It could be both, right?
Like, right. One final note, I think, for me on this portfolio, and we'll take a look at the next one after this, I think, is that obviously here there's a call to action. Let's connect if you're interested in working together. Mm-hmm. But I don't see an email on here. Obviously, there's tons of other ways to get in touch. This messaging feature, there I can find you on the web, but all these are sort of additional clicks. I know in my case, often email is the primary venue that I use to kind of reach out to artists, and so I always advocate, if you're looking for work, if you want to be contacted, make it as easy as possible. Put it up here as a byline near the top. Definitely put it in the About Me section. But web references are also really great. It's great to kind of find where else you might exist on the interwebs. So,
totally.
Yeah. Thank you, Ryan, for submitting your portfolio. I think you're probably eating your lunch, so I hope it's delicious, and you can take a look at the replay to hear Lucas's feedback. And then our second portfolio that we are reviewing, Valter Fria Filho, graphic and UI UX designer, content maker out of Brazil.
Florianópolis.
Yeah. Oh, you are from Brazil.
I'm from Brazil, so Valter Fria Filho.
Do you know where this is?
Florianópolis. I sure do. I've never been there, but it's beautiful from what I understand.
Right. Well, yeah, I should have let you pronounce the name.
No, it's all good. Hey, Valter.
Yeah. Hi there. Okay, cool. So, here we go. Graphic designer, graduate photographer, video maker, curious future UX UI designer. Very cool.
Cool.
Yeah. Overall thoughts?
So I think it's interesting to go from this really large, but a lot of projects to like a much more focused portfolio. He has sort of like these categories of like, you know, calendars 2018 and then banners, digital banners. Curious how he structured those within that. I'm curious about the you know, if you're gonna have like these sort of like subcategories within Behance, I wonder if it makes sense to maybe handle those consistently. So maybe, you know, that's it, having like a system for how you sort of title those things, especially because it looks like more so he's catering towards like putting a portfolio to showcase his work.
Shall we dive into one?
Yeah,
let's kind of see how it's organized.
So these are calendars that I think get popped out or cut out and then built into these little...
Oh, wow.
Yeah, wild. So one thing I think that... I think it's looking like just a little, like, smoky or something. I think that, like, just opening up, like, this gray is kind of suffocating a little. And the moments in which, like, you break, like, there's, like, I can see the line. I don't know, it goes from, like, a cool gray and then, like, to, like a more of a yellow gray.
Oh, yeah.
And then there's, like, some movement in there, which I think is all, like, nice, but it's starting to feel just a little, like, attic, like dusty or something. So opening that up a little bit, and even in the images, kind of opening them up a little bit. And maybe there's, like, a little bit too much, like, gradient movement with some of these, where I feel like, you know, I see that you put a lot of effort, like, you know, cropping these out and dropping a background and all of that, which I think, you know, it's it's great to understand the object, but there's just like a lot of like, just like this gradient swooping just keeps happening, you think?
Yeah, I think I would tend to agree that these objects themselves, they are dimensional, and the application of color in them is obviously really strong, and therefore I think maybe the gray is not helping because it's not letting that color sing as much as possible.
Yeah.
I mean, you push it all the way and put it on white or something, and it's just like the object itself becomes really celebrated as a result of that. Yeah. And maybe some of the gray is dulling it down a little bit. And again, I think like it's kind of a cool like use of scale like this.
Mm-hmm.
This is a really interesting implementation, like
yeah,
isolating them from the background and putting them into the project. It feels like the shapes and balance and everything here feels like the design that's kind of printed on it, like a little light, bouncy. And
yeah, that's like the more exciting moment, I think. And even like it doesn't attempt to pretend like, the, you know, like that there's this fake space. I do think that there might be a little bit of a... like you didn't multiply the shadow onto the back, so there's like it actually gets like a little bit brighter right around the shadow, between the shadow and the background, which is like a little bit of a weird optical like illusion almost. So I think, I mean, that's just like a small like retouching note, but to like get that shadow on a different get the shadow on a different layer from the object and actually multiply it onto that background, so it's actually, you know, additive instead of like slightly brighter than the actual background is. But I think rethinking maybe the color for the background altogether would be nice. But I kind of want to start with this, and I think you can even get more playful with the position, but I think that's sort of like the, I don't know, probably the most compelling moment of
to
understand.
Yeah, bringing that up top would be kind of interesting, because it does take a moment to figure out what you're looking at, and by the time you understand its final form, which I thought was a really awesome moment to see this and be like, wow, it holds your pens and pencils. Bring that up to the top. I think a lot of people on the internet, you know, the attention span is so short these days too, that they want to like be hooked by something, like drawn in really, really quickly. So sometimes that means putting the final product up top, breaking it down, and then resolving it in the same way.
And like this title, I think it's great that you spent some time and you put something together, but as you're, if you close that, I think, unless we're not done talking about it, but if you close it and you see it like within the context of all the projects, it kind of scales down a little bit too much, where I had no idea what that pink blue shape was, you know?
Yeah.
It's just like it's too small to try. Like once you click in, so maybe you can, you know, let that be if you're happy with it, but add a different image that's just sort of like the title and maybe movement of color behind it or whatever you want to do. But having that image at that scale there, I don't think does too much for you.
Cool. You want to look at maybe what's a larger brand or just a logo?
Sure, yeah. I mean, I'm curious about that last one, too.
Oh, this one?
The sample box.
Okay.
Box Massisa. Is it patterned inside? Yeah, I think this one, I mean, this one is being handled more like a deck or something, where it's kind of being, like, pretty clean and thorough in its documentation.
This is for, like, fabrics?
Let's go back down. Is it for fabrics or is it? No, I think it's for a luminous. So it's composite. Like, sorry, let me.
So.
Yeah, it's like fake wood, I think.
Oh.
Is that what it is? Yeah, like or
yeah, is it laminate, perhaps.
Yeah, it has like the individual like slides or whatever I think he's calling them, color plates. Simulation display.
Kind of an interesting project. Like it's not, I mean, often people are doing boxes or cans or bottles, things like that. I mean, this has a sort of entirely different need, I imagine. So there's kind of something really interesting about that.
Design historical reference I'll give you that I think like did a lot of projects like this. Like Piet Zwart, which are like crazy, but he did all kinds of like molding and like factory stuff and like all that energy and experimentation and kind of like wild language. I think nowadays when we see those kind of catalogs, we can barely believe that somebody let him do that for like a knob company or whatever it was. So I just, yeah, I love his work, so I'll just throw that out there. But yeah, this looks like pretty clean. I wonder about sort of the thumbnail before we click in. I think, I mean, maybe that's the, I guess the thing that I'm wondering about it is that like sliver of white,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which maybe is nitpicking. But it's kind of just like, yeah, it's kind of just, it's not doing much. I think maybe scale the box as, you know, to the size of that frame and just let that green bleed all the way through. I mean, it's a very kind of like prescriptive and small piece of advice, but.
Yeah, no, I think, I mean, I think it's interesting, the UI of Behance and the thumbnail, like
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You do have to kind of make considerations for where, and understand where your graphic choices might sort of imply a different kind mm-hmm. of space. As it is currently, it kind of looks like something is a little askew here. And
Walter's mentioning that this box is for architects and interior designers, so I think also that's like kind of an interesting project where you have to cater to professionals specifically instead of like, so maybe it's specific. I'm thinking of it almost like, you know, Pantone swatch
yeah.
or something like
yeah.
that, where
yeah.
it's like a professional that's going through this, and or you're at Home Depot and you're going through like rug samples or whatever, but more specifically for someone that's putting together a room and trying to resolve it.
Cool.
Yeah, that's cool.
I think we had 30 seconds left about 30 seconds ago, so we're going to have to wrap up the portfolio reviews, but awesome work, everyone that submitted. Glad to have a chance to take a look at it. Thank you for sharing it, obviously, with the world and with
yeah,
us.
Yeah, thanks, guys.
And I want to thank Lucas for stopping by this whole week. This is the final stream of the day. Lucas's final stream this week. So thanks to everybody who tuned in at any point this week. We'll be going live 2 weeks from now, I think. Next week is off. So be sure to check this URL again in 2 weeks. There's going to be some awesome content coming up. Do you want to let anybody know where to like follow your work, or do you want to just say see ya?
I'm on, you know, you guys can reach out to me on Behance if you want to talk about anything or show me anything or ask me any questions.
Yeah,
that's about it.
Yeah, you can find his links probably in the bio tab. So thank you everybody for watching. Tune in a couple weeks, and for now, we will see you later. Bye.